السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته. الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاه والسلام على اسعد الانبياء واشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين. وارض اللهم عن الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين بكرهم وفاروقهم وذي النورين وابي السبطين عليهم من الله جميعا رضوان. أما بعد، إلهي تغني لك الحمد عن كاس وعن ساقي، بك اتحدت هدى. أما بعد، to our brothers and sisters around the world, wherever you may be around the world, and our respected non-Muslim viewers, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower his blessings and also mercy unto all of you. Ameen. Welcome back. Today we will be talking about the new Eratosthenes or Betelgeuse or V.Y. Kenneth Majors, biologist, or let me say scientist. They will catch the terms that I'm using because with stars. But the one that we're talking about today and the Imam that we will explore and talk about him today is the Imam who traveled the world patiently, learning, teaching. He was criticized throughout his life, but he did not care but to please his Lord. The one I'm talking about, this Imam, is known as Imam Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat Abu Imara, or Ammara as they call him. The Imam of today, he was actually from Kufa. If you remember Imam al-Shatibi, what he said, وبالكوفة الغراء منهم ثلاثة أذاعوا فقد ضاعت شذا وقرنفلا فأما أبو بكر فعاصم اسمه فشعبة راويه المبرز أفضلا وذاك ابن عياش أبو بكر الرضا وحفص وبالإتقان كان مفضلا وحمزة ما أزكاه من متورع إماما صبورا للقرآن مرتلا. The Imam of today is Imam Hamza al-Zayyat rahimahullah. The reason why they call this Imam al-Zayyat, because Zayyat is the plural form of al-Zayt. And Zayt in Arabic language is what we call in English oil. So the oil that sometimes we use to eat or we use for different purposes in our life, actually is called in Arabic al-Zayt. This Imam was known as al-Zayyat. What did he used to do? He used to travel, take some oil all the way from where he was in Kufa to, you know, Hulwan, another part in Iraq. He will go over there, sell it, and from there, returning back to his place, he will buy jubna, or he will buy something like cheese, and then take it back to his city and then sell. So you can see this Imam did not used to depend on what people will give him here and there. He was a merchant. He was a businessman. What he used to do is that he used to take care of himself. It is mentioned, one of his students said, well-known Imam came to him from Kufa to reside unto him in Kufa. The Imam was well-known and he was rich. He recited Quran unto him. When he recited Quran unto Hamza, he attempted to pay and give him what he recited and the time and the hour that he took to read on him. So he took something, and they said he gave him like 80 dirhams. At the time, it's very valuable amount of money. But Imam Hamza denied and he refused. When he refused, he said, no, this is from my heart. I'm giving it to you willingly. I'm giving it to you from my heart. I'm doing it from my heart. Nobody is forcing me to do it, and I will not hold something in my chest because of that. I'm doing it because I want to. Imam said, no, never. I will not take it from you. What I'm doing, what I taught you right now, أبتغي بذلك الفردوس الأعلى. I'm hoping for Almighty Allah سبحانه عما نواله وجل جلاله وتقدست أسماؤه. I hope the ever compelling master of the entire universe will compensate He will compensate me with this by giving me Jannat al-Firdaus, the highest level of Jannah on the day of Qiyamah. Jannat al-Firdaus, that is what I'm waiting, and that's what I'm hoping for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reciprocate me due to what I'm doing. So I don't need it. I will pause here momentarily to say the following. To our brothers and sisters worldwide, you see, these imams that we're talking about, we're not talking about them just because we want to, you know, kill time, as people say, or because we have, you know, nothing to do. Thus, we want to talk about them and have some beautiful story. We're not just giving you a beautiful story. We're talking about them so that we can take some lessons. We can cogitate, ponder, and decipher over their lifestyle, the way they lived. Today, if you were to ask somebody, you know, bring me your son, let me teach him Quran, or you advise someone, take your son to Tahfiz, let him memorize Quran, or since we're in Egypt, take your son to Kutab, let them learn Arabic, or let them learn Quran, they will tell you, well, in Ta'ayiz ibn a sheikh, do you want my son to be a sheikh? Is that what you want for my son to be? I don't want my son to be sheikh. What you talking about? So to them, it's like memorizing Quran is preparing the kids to be sheikh tomorrow. Says who? If your son memorized Quran, my brother in faith, does not mean he has to be a sheikh. If he memorized or she memorized Quran, doesn't mean he should be an imam. This is Allah's book. هَذَا كَلَامُ اللَّهِ. This is the words of Almighty Allah. خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. Your son, you want him to be a doctor? Mashi. Well, and that's nice and beautiful. We want a lot of doctors. But if we have a doctor who memorizes or computes and committed the entire book of Allah to memory, can you compare him with someone who has nothing in his heart from Allah's book? Can you compare a scientist who had committed all book and scripture of Allah into his heart? Can you compare him with someone, he or she, who has nothing from Allah's book in his or her heart? Can you compare someone who had memorized Quran and he is a computer scientist, or he is an engineer, for instance, or he is a person, let's say a builder, or someone who is benefiting the society, psychiatrist, let's say. If you have that and he has Quran memorized, or she has Quran memorized, can you compare them with someone who has that, who has not memorized Quran? Absolutely not. The distance between two of them is like that distance between our son and V.Y. Kenneth Majors. It's like the distance between Proxima Centauri and sun that we have in our own solar system that is closer to it. And also Alpha Centauri, the way it is far from our sun, the distance between the one who has Quran memorized and someone who did not memorize the book of Allah, they can never be the same. But here I will say, why people denigrating, defaming, casting aspersion on those who memorize Quran? Oftentimes because they think those who memorize Allah's book, they do not have no job, they begging people and they following. So when you have an imam who had memorized Quran or someone who is a student of knowledge, he says, I want to meet with this doctor. The first thing that will run into that doctor's medulla oblongata and his brain is that, well, I don't want to meet him because I know he's coming to ask me for sadaqah. He's coming to ask me for sadaqah, so I don't want to even see him. So because of that, they do not have no value. But a person memorizing Quran, being a sheikh and his businessman, being a sheikh and he has his own business that he runs halal. I don't say those who do that have, you know, value and more taqwa than those who don't and they memorize. I'm not saying that. But if we want people, always like they say, if you want people to know that you don't actually, what you're doing for them is sincerely from your heart. You don't want them to know, but just for them to respect what you're giving, you don't need what they have in their hands. You're doing it for Allah. But today, defaming those who have Allah's book, no, having respect for them, thinking that they will be chasing and going behind those who have it. So the book of Allah, when you recite, people even today think the reciters, they are actually arghabu butuna. They're following and chasing people. That's not the case. I'm saying this because of the situation that we're seeing and witnessing. The book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, due to the situation that we're living in, some of those who had been blessed with it, and Almighty Allah had given them the blessing by memorizing the book of Allah, they do not, some, I'm not saying all, some do not follow the code. So a lot of people, they do not even have respect for those who actually carry that task and who actually carry that book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to our sisters, I would like to say, and our brothers likewise, here is Imam Hamza radiallahu anhu wa ardah. He used to run his own business at the same time, teaching Quran. Imam Qari al-Kufa. Imam Abu Hanifa, do you know what he said about this Imam? Do you know? I guess probably you don't. Or if you do, probably you forget. Or if you did not forget, probably right now you're doing something else. Just hold on a minute. Stay tuned, you know, stay tight in your couch. Let me tell you what Abu Hanifa said about this Imam. Abu Hanifa said about Imam Abu Ammar Hamza ibn Habib ibn Zayyad. He said to him one day, Shay'ani ghalabtana fihima ya Hamza. Two things that you defeated us in them. لا ننازعك فيهما أبدا. We cannot compete with you in them. We can't. We cannot actually chase you. We can't compete with you in two things. Abu Hanifa, see, An-Nu'man ibn Thabit al-Kufi, this Imam of Iraq. So he said to him, do you know what he said about him? He said two things that you defeated all the Imams in, O Imam Hamza. One is Quran. Two is the knowledge and the science of fara'id. The science that deals with distributing and also sharing, you know, when somebody, what we know as in the knowledge of inheritance. He was well known, and they used to say he was actually a mathematician. So see, a hafiz, imam, mathematician, why we cannot have a hafiz and follow the suit of Imam Hamza al-Zayyat? And his teacher was Imam al-A'mash, rahimahullah. A'mash was blind. Whenever Imam al-A'mash sees his student coming, he used to say, Hadha Habbur al-Quran. This is the teacher of Quran. And he also used to say, whenever he sees his student, he used to say, Wa Bashir al-Muhsineen, and glad tidings to those rightly guided. Inshallah, we will take a short break. We come back, bi-idhnillahi tabarak wa ta'ala, and continue with Hamza. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
إنا نحن نزلنا الذكر وإنا له لحافظون.
Alhamdulillah, welcome back. Before the break, you know, we talked about Imam Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat, and I'm your brother that you know, Ukash Akameni. We're still talking about this esteemed scholar and this tremendous amount of knowledge that Almighty Allah stored in the system of this Imam. According to Imam Khalaf ibn Hisham, on the authority of Sulaym, who said, I heard from our Imam Hamza, who said that he actually recited on, when he was asked, when Hamza was asked, who did you recite your Quran onto? Imam Hamza affirmatively responded, he said, the one unto whom I recited my Quran and I presented my ard. In Arabic, when they say arad al-Quran ala fulan, it's not like sami'a or qara. When we say arad, means he sat down and he recited from A to Z, and the sheikh is listening and is giving him exactly what he learned. So he presented his ard and he recited unto the following two well-known imams. The first imam that Imam Hamza recited unto was Imam al-A'mash, al-Hafidh al-Kabir, al-Muhaddith al-Faqih. This Imam al-A'mash, Imam Malik used to actually hold, the nosebound of his camel or horse whenever he goes to perform Hajj or Umrah. See, Imam Dar al-Hijra, كان يمسك بزمام ناقته. He used to hold. Subhanallah, that means Imam al-A'mash, he was tremendous Imam. And also Imam Sufyan al-Thawri used to do it. Once al-A'mash entered in Medina, and from there he went to Mecca, when they heard, when Imam Sufyan al-Thawri and Imam Malik, Imam Dar al-Hijran, both of them heard that Imam, actually al-A'mash is coming to perform Hajj, both of them went, and they started waiting for him over there before his even arrival. When he arrived, Imam Malik held onto the noseband of the camel from front. whereas Imam al-Thawr Sufyan is behind holding, and they both saying, أَفْسِخُوا لِلشَّيْخ, يعني وَسِّعُوا لِلشَّيْخ, open the door, the sheikh is coming. Subhanallah, يعني, when you listen or you talk about this type of, this kind of people, you think, were they really people? Imam Dalil, the Imam of the whole Medina, holding on to somebody's animal and saying, أَوْسِعُوا لِلشَّيْخ, and Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, the Hafidh al-Kabir, that they said he never heard something in his life without memorizing it. And when you memorize, you never forget, except that which Almighty Allah permits him to forget or decreed for him to forget. So this Imam al-Hafidh al-Kabir, both of them used to treat Imam al-A'mash this way. Now, do you think if somebody memorized, if somebody had memorized Juz Amma or Juz Tabarak, and he had opened his own masjid in the basement, and he thinks in the city that he in, he Sheikh al-Islam, another big sheikh comes, he will say to them, "Awsi'u al-Sheikh." Say, "No, no, I'm not gonna do that. I'm the Sheikh al-Islam of this town. I don't care whoever you might be. I know I'm the man for the plan. Here, I'm the Sheikh." And that's why you see this sheikh will bombard this, and this sheikh will defend that, and this person will talk about this and this and start talking. But listen to the behavior of those imams, great imams. So basically what I'm trying to say is that Imam al-A'mash that Sufyan al-Thawri used to admire and respect, and also Imam al-Hafidh al-Kabir, Imam Dar al-Hijr used to admire and respect. Both of them used to respect and honor Imam al-A'mash. وَكَانَ al-A'mash ضَرِيرَ. A'mash, he was actually blind. But the one whom Imam al-A'mash taught and recited Quran unto, and the student took recitation from A'mash, was this Imam, Imam Hamza. So you can see he was great Imam. So Imam Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat, he took from Imam A'mash. And he also took from another Imam known as Muhammad ibn Abd al-Rahman ibn Abi Layla. One of the biggest Imams, ibn Abi Layla, Muhammad ibn Abd al-Rahman. Muhammad ibn Abd al-Rahman ibn Abi Layla, it is said when Imam Hamza was asked, "Now you say that you took from Imam al-A'mash, and you also took from Ibn Abi Layla. So now we know that those imams, they learned from the Sahaba of Rasulullah. Can you tell us how you sifted between the narration and chain of transmission?" He said to them confidently, he said, "Actually, whatever I recite through A'mash is what A'mash received from Imam Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And whatever I recited onto Imam Ibn Abi Layla is what Ibn Abi Layla actually took from Imam Ali radiallahu anhu anil jami'. So you can see the narration that he had, he did not actually fabricate that from himself. The reason why you see me saying this, and I'm also confirming the teachers of Imam Hamza, the reason why you say I'm doing this and I did not do that and praise the Imam of those Qura that I mentioned, even though the Imam is supposed to be praised also in detail, but because the time that I have is really short, that's why I didn't do that, but I'm doing it with Hamza, because we have some Imams who criticize Imam Hamza, and we're talking about great Imams, great Imams, like in Wasit, it is mentioned in Wasit that what happened, Yazid ibn Harun, he sent a letter to the leader of Wasit. He said, لا تسمح لأي أحد أن يقرأ في مسجدنا بقراءة حمزة. Do not allow anyone to teach someone or to teach in our masjid the recitation of Hamza. Don't do that. Don't allow anyone to do it. Don't do it. That's what they said. Don't do it. And they kept on pressing on that. Even to a point, Imam Sufyan ibn Uyayna, he said, لو صليت خلف من يقرأ, يعني لو صليت خلف من يقرأ بقراءة حمزة لأعدت, يعني لأعدت صلاتي. That's what Ibn Uyayna said, meaning if I end up praying behind someone who recites the recitation of this Imam, Imam Hamza, I will repeat my salah because I didn't like that recitation. And Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal used to say, I hate that recitation. So this, they are big imams that we cannot say anything about, and we cannot, you know, talk about them. Those are big imams, tremendous imams, great shuyukh and big mashayikh. We can talk, you know, bad about them. But you see, here, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, he said what he said, but another big imam, the biggest, Al-Hafidh Al-Kabir, who is considered to be the Hafidh of those whom I just mentioned, Sufyan Al-Thawri, he said, لم يقرأ حمزة إلا بأثر. لم يقرأ حمزة إلا بأثر. Hamza never recited anything in his recitation without a text. So whatever he recited, it's not from him. That's through the chain. That's why once they said he was actually sitting down and his heart was filled and packed with sorrow. When his student entered in his house, he asked him, why are you confused this way? Or why are you confused, O Imam? He said, because people are criticizing my recitation. Then he asked him, okay, well, who taught you? He said, the one who actually taught me is A'mash. Okay, A'mash, who taught A'mash? He said, the chain of A'mash came via Imam, Ibrahim al-Nakhai. And he said, Abba Ibrahim al-Nakhai, where did he get his recitation from? He said, actually, he got it from Alqama. He said, well, Alqama, where did he get his chain from? He said, through Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the Sahabi. Then he asked him, okay, where did Abdullah ibn Mas'ud get his own chain and also recitation? He said, from Prophet. He said, where did Prophet ﷺ receive his recitation from? He said, from Jibreel. Where did Jibreel get that recitation from? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gave it to him. Then the student said to the Shaykh, وَهَلْ لَهُمْ إِسْنَادٌ مِثْلَ هَذَا الْإِسْنَادٌ Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Do they have chain of transmission like that of yours? That's what they say. You know, sometimes the Shaykh can be confused and the one to calm him down is maybe sometimes either the one closer to him, maybe his son, his wife, or his student, or someone who is not up to his status. You see, so that's what happened. So he said, if they criticize, those who criticize in your recitation, they don't have this chain. So why will you bother yourself, just like Imam al-Sakhawi used to say, you know, وَأَيْنَ الْعُلَمَاءِ مِنْ تَعْرِيفَاتِ الْجُهَلَاءِ Why will actually scholars care about the definitions that the ignorant ones will take? Actually, he said that when he was talking about, you know, his translation on the book of Al-Aqila, and he named the book Al-Kashf. But, you know, I don't want to digress, so let me come back here. So the point here is, those who criticize the recitation of Hamza, Imam al-Dhahabi said the reason why they did so is because in his recitation, you know, there are actually a lot of differences that none of the imams actually had in their recitation. Example, the imala, al-kubra, al-idja'at, and al-waqf, and these kind of things, that's what made them. But when they say that they deny, they do not mean they deny the chain of it. The chain is together. So if the chain is together, what they say has no value. That qara'a is mutawatira, and that recitation is from Nabi, and these are the chains that came from Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is what A'immatul Kibar had actually confirmed, and this is what all of them took. So this Imam Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyad al-Kufi rahimahullah, his qara'a came actually from two students. One of them is known as, you know, Khalaf ibn Hisham al-Bazzar al-Baghdadi. This great Imam, he actually took his knowledge from Imam Sulaym, because he did not meet Hamza. Another student who took from Hamza is Imam Khalad. So actually Khalad, both of them did not meet. Khalad and Khalaf, they did not meet Hamza. Rather, the one that they took the recitation from is Sulaym. So from Sulaym, they get the recitation of Hamza, just like Susi and Duri through Yahya al-Yazidi. They took from Abi Amr al-Basri, the same thing also this student. Imam al-Hafidh al-Kabir, he mentioned in his book when he said, وَحَمْزَةُ مَا أَزْكَاهُ مِنْ مُتَوَرِّعٍ إِمَامًا صَبُورًا لِلْقُرَانِ مُرَتِّلًا أَفَاضَ عَلَى يَحْيَ الْيَزِيدِيِّ That was for Abi Amr al-Basri. But here he said Khalaf and who? Khalad, both of them took from this great Imam Sulaym. So Sulaym took from Hamza, and he actually gave the recitation of Hamza to those two. Insha'Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala, we've come to the end of this episode. When we come to our next episode, what we will do, we will take some samples from the recitation of Imam Al-Hafidh Al-Kabir, Hamza ibn Habib Al-Zayyad. through his student, actually Sulaym, the way he taught Imam Khalaf and Khallat. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله الذي وحده على والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
لتقرأه على الناس على مكث ونزلناه تنزيلا
وقرآنا فرقناه لتقرأه على الناس على مكث